Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for being a part of this session as well. I know it's the fag end of the day, and you would have already exhausted yourself from, you know, the number of presentations that you would have gone through and absorbed all of them. So let's hope, you know, we keep this entertaining, we keep this informative. I know the very nature of this particular presentation should make it interesting. It's about fashion. It's about, you know, how we can dress better and how we can make the retailers smarter. So we have this product called Dressire. It's an advanced analytics, machine learning, and AI-based solution that is for malls, retailers, fashion brands, and airports. And what it does is it helps them understand what products can be shown to which customer in real time. It works both online as well as in the brick and mortar, you know, offline space. Now, it's a brick and mortar offline space, which is what we are primarily targeting. To give a bit of a context, you all can see these slides, and that will set the context of, you know, why we are doing what we are doing. You know, our mission, as you would have seen, is to make sure that the brick and mortar retailers are well equipped to handle the onslaught of Amazon and help them prevent getting Amazoned. And how do we do it is what we'll cover in the following slides. So you can see very well the current state of retail. You know, these three charts say it all. The proportion of online purchases going up, though we understand that clothing as a space is not very amenable for you know, for online buying. It's not so conducive as maybe a book or music. So there is some opportunity, there is some hope for all offline retailers. And how we do it, you know, how do we make sure that, you know, that they can not just get consumed by the discount warfare, you know, which the likes of Flipkart or Amazon or any other big e-commerce daddy is raging, you know, in the scenario, but they should be able to stand up and, you know, and hold on to what their strengths are, which is provide the touch and feel experience coupled with providing, you know, a much, much more superlative customer experience. Now, to enable this, you know, there are three must-haves that retailers need to have. Digital fluency holds the central role in here. Equipping them with understanding the customer's behavior is paramount. See, what the e-commerce players have is they're able to track each and every click of the customer and understand the customer's behavior, look at her purchase history, look at her click stream, and are able to provide some recommendations, you know, in real time. How accurate they are, you know, that's a topic for another discussion. And what's the scope for further improvement? You know, we can always debate on that. Now, once they are equipped with digital fluency, they should be able to understand customer, who she is, what she wants, what her preferences are, and how can we serve them better as she walks into the store. Right? Because when the customer walks into the store, you know nothing about her. You don't know who's walked in, what she likes, and how can she serve her better. If the retailers can be equipped to provide this kind of a, you know, assisted recommendations, clienteling as you call it, you know, then it would be a very different experience, both for the customers and, you know, pretty beautiful for the retailers as well. And once they are equipped with information about customer, the intelligence, you know, that is needed, then they would be able to respond faster to the change in customer demands. The customers' preferences change. If retailers can be made aware of what the aggregate preferences of customers are given any particular region, then they should be able to know what to stock in which store, and further on, what they should be manufacturing, which has a higher probability of, you know, flying off the shelves. So this is the biggest problem that customers have. Customers in the store, and you don't know who is who and what they want. So anyways, the biggest problem is, you know, how do you drive the traffic back into the stores? So we'll come to this. And we spoke about this. Customers today, you know, are accessing your digital storefront through various channels, be it mobile, be it the website, you know, and through different devices as well. they even shop offline. So how do you get a consistent view of the customer so you're able to recognize that this is she and this is what she wants? Well, now let's look at it from the customer's standpoint. There are three Fs as we know it from a shopper's perspective. Three problems: find, fit, flatter. Find is all about, well, you know, where can I find what I want? Is it in that shop or is it in this, you know, with this retailer, that department store? And does it have that particular top or the dress that I'm looking for? Fit, will it suit me? You know, how well will it, you know, augment my style, my body shape? And then, you know, what do I pair it with? So how Dressire helps, you know, address these pain points, it all starts with understanding what the customer is influenced by. Understanding, you know, what she's looking at, understanding the social context, capturing her stated and unstated needs, which is so much more important. Understanding her body proportions, so you can find the match between the different products that are there and the, you know, the set of customers who come in various, you know, body shapes. Over a period of time, we built a rich product genome, you know, which breaks down each garment into an atomic level, into its attributes. And together, you know, this will construct the complete garment. So I'm talking about features like not just the fabric, but what kind of fabric, colors, different shades of colors, prints, what size of prints, what color of prints, what's location, what's the density, you know, and how do they impact the customer. There are hundreds of attributes that we consider. You know, sorry. Oops. Wrong button. Yeah. So essentially, you know, it starts with catering to the digital first scenario, starting with the online journey, ensuring that this customer walks into the store, build a complete universal profile data set of the customer, which goes beyond the boundary of any particular retailer, and personalize the entire inventory in real time. The differentiator we have is that the algorithms work even if you do not have any historical data about the customer. So, you know nothing about the customer. On the fly, can you understand the customer? Now, if you recall, that is exactly what used to happen in the mom-and-pop stores of yesteryears. And that's the whole magic we want to recreate. The malls, the department stores, have grown in size. Big enough not to recognize you. Big enough not to provide the kind of exclusive service that you want. In the golden era, you could walk into that mom-and-pop store. The store owner would know you by name, would know what brand of cheese you like, and would have it stocked for you. That's the kind of interaction, that's the kind of experience we want to provide. Okay, so coming to the features we have as very first one, personalized navigation. And what it does is, if a retailer has a million customers, we create a million stores. Yeah? Each customer can have her own unique store, which will have items that she wants to see. So you cut through the clutter. You don't see what you don't want to see. You have something in mind, it should pop up in front of you. You don't need to even type. Style and Fit Advisor, and you know, that works for apparel, that works for jewelry, and we have a bra fit advisor, so it's, you know, there in the lingerie space as well. An outfit builder, given each item, what do you pair it with? What shoes, what accessories, what outerwear, what bottom wear, the works. And you know, it provides multiple options for you, for each one of you, for each product. And then, you know, on the BI suite front, given the deep level of customer intelligence we have, like I said, you have attribute level intelligence about each customer. You can leverage that to do one-to-one marketing, because you have understanding of what the customer wants and how she wants to be reached, and you can provide her content which is contextually aware and which is relevant for that customer and each customer. And demand planning insights, like I mentioned earlier, you would help the retailer understand what items can be shown to who. So we have a demo for you, which we can run through for the personalized navigation. So here, you know, there's a typical app, let's say, or a site of a retailer. You browse through all the different clothes one by one until you reach a particular dress that you are looking for. The other way is, you know, you can click on your personalized navigation, just like it would be in a mom and pop store. You know, you walk in, they show you a few items, which is what we do. We show you a few items, dresses here in this particular case. All you have to do is let us know how well you like them or don't like them. So maybe we can fast forward this. You know, it will run on for some time. Because, you know, depending on the garments that we have in here, it could be anywhere from 10 to 15, which would take you, you know, maybe a minute to answer, a minute or two. But this is to be done just once. It's not that each time you decide to go shopping, we'll pop up these questions in front of you. It is done just once. You build your profile, you are set. Each time you go to the shop or any shop, you will have the entire inventory of that shop in front of you on your digital, you know, device. So this is how the profile is made. And once it is made, you know, you have a simple sign-up process. You know, you enter your name, your email ID, your mobile number. And there was an additional question as well, since, you know, we were doing this particular app for a certain retailer, whether they are the loyal members or not. So once this is done, yeah, you sign up, select the age group, and you sign up, and lo and behold, you know, from here on, you will see your personal closet. Now, these are items that you would want to see for you, for yourself. So every time the retailer has new season's clothes, you would see those which really matter to you, which you would have a affinity for. So that's how, you know, it works. And we can move on to the style picks, the fit advisor, the style advisor. And I'd request Mridula, my head of technology, to walk us through that.
Okay. You want this? Thank you. Thanks for that. Okay, so the mic is not fitting me somehow, so I'll have to use this mic. So anyway, so now coming to the style picks part. So initially we thought of all the preferences that a customer wants or what she likes. And based on that, we showed what, you know, she would want to see. But there are a few factors where we understand what would fit her better. What is her style? What will look good on her? So this is one demo which shows about the style picks. Yeah. Again, you go to the app, you click the style picks part. Here we ask a few questions about the body proportions so that we know what will suit a particular customer. So very simple questions. And they also have images, so you know it's easy to understand. We have given some illustrations. So based on that, we show them, you know, what would fit them better. And we also have some stars at the top, which shows them which is the best, which is okay, which is average, you know, all those. So 5-star, 4-star, 3-star. So based on that, they can do it. And once they have done this, they can select a particular category and look for that particular category. If they are looking for tops or trousers or dresses, they can choose that category and go ahead. And then look at the inventory.
Is that, you know, when it comes to style picks, you know, sometimes you don't have anything in mind. You know, you are open for the retailer to suggest something for you. So in this particular case, 20 seconds is what it takes to make your style advisory, you know, profile. Once you have that, you know, 6 questions is what we asked. It's gone some further changes. Once you have that, you'd be able to see the entire inventory across categories, be it dresses, be it tops, be it trousers, be it skirts. You know, as of now, we are doing it for women. So I know there's a majority of men in here, but you know, we will be coming out with menswear personalization as well. So you know, 20 seconds effort would yield, you know, information to you about which items would best suit you. So I think from here on, we'll take you through a
case study,
you know, a quick case study of, you know, what we've done with a large department store. These are, you know, some images from that particular, you know, moment. Now, what we did was we set up a small, 10 by 15 area. Which was just outside the Western wear, you know, women's trial room. and we had this tablet and a, you know, and a desktop in there. Any customers, you know, who would spot us would, you know, who would come to us, would make their profile, and they would be able to see the entire inventory, and you know, they could choose and buy from there on. Now, one of the things that we'd like to highlight is, you know, the conversions. So we were able to drive about 50 to 60% of, you know, conversions improvement. And we were able to influence 20 to 30% of their incremental sales. Basket size, again, you know, went up by the same percentage, about 50, 60%. Yeah, so we are also, you know, working with some top jewelry brands, lingerie brands, and, you know, we are, you know, as we speak, exploring Europe, you know, and other geographies as well. We have a partner, Digital Effect, in there. We work through USD Global. Of course, we are accelerating, you know, we are being accelerated by Oracle. And we were finalists in some of the events. Here is a second case study, which, you know, Mridula would take us to.
So we also did one pilot with South Asia's luxury lingerie brand. So where we gave them a fit advice, and you know, we advised the customers to actually take the measurements and then go for lingerie. So we found that 90% of the customers were satisfied with the fit, the advice that we provided, because it was not just the advice on what size, but what style they should go for. So it also had a lot many other factors which told them what would suit them the best. And even 96% of the customers who used the solution bought those items because they were right suggestions for them.
So this, and when compared with the with those who did not use a solution, the conversion rate was around 42%. So that is the difference, as you can see, in conversion. Sorry, over to you. Okay. So now we'll come to the next slide.
So this again gives you a graphical representation of you know, the lingerie case study. So, which is on based on the customers and what styles fit them. So, most of we had made various bus profiles based on our questions and our this thing. So, based on that, we found out that 25% of the customers fit in a particular bus profile, and so the retailer knows what to stock more or what styles are best suited. So, we also showed them a granular level of each style that suits the customer or is the best recommended one for the customers. So based on that, you have a granular graph as well here, which tells you the best suited style and which they should be stocking in their shops more.
Yep. So one more.
Yeah, this again gives them an insight of the sizes that they should go for, the more number of sizes that are, you know, there in their customers. So based on their customers, they can stock again those sizes or make those sizes.
Okay. So here is one quick case study.
One quick, demo on our jewelry application. So here also we suggest which jewelry suits whom. So we get to know about the skin tone or that by using these questions. Their face shape, what suits them more. Yeah, so once they have answered these questions about it, about their body shapes and all, they can choose a category that they want to shop, and then they will see the most suited jewelry for them. So this is something we are doing with a jewelry brand here in Bangalore. And they can like any of those, whichever they like, they can heart it using the red heart button. This tells about the, so once you heart it, you can see it in the cart, and then you can go to the cart and see what you have hearted, so what you have liked. So the sales executive there can get these items for you, and you can try it on. if you want to see a detailed description, you can again go to the detailed description page and see the item.
Okay. So,
I'll now hand it over to Madhu, who is our technical mentor at Oracle. So he'll be doing this.
Thanks, Ashish. Thanks, Madhu. Is the recording clear? Okay, thank you. Guys, I'm from Oracle Startup Cloud Accelerator, or what we call OSCAR. You might be seeing us outside here, like we're having a booth. And I think I interacted with a couple of you folks here. If you are a startup, then you definitely need to talk to us. With me, I have Pawan, who is also a program manager. Hi, Pawan. So basically, what I would be like to talk is, I'm a cloud tech mentor at Oracle Startup Cloud Accelerator. This is the architecture that this company, Dressire, who's one of our cohort selected teams, and this is the startup architecture they had initially on Amazon, AWS. What you can see here is they had a bunch of Tomcat machines along with MongoDB initially, and they were running it on EC2. And they were actually integrating with a couple of retailers and news feeds. And for load balancing, they were using HAProxy, once again, open source solution. And this is the initial setup that they had on AWS. As a part of the program, what we do is we give startups a cloud credit worth of a couple of thousands of dollars. And then we also guide them to migrate to Oracle Cloud. Can you just move to the next slide?
Yeah, go on. Hold on.
That's okay.
Yeah.
Here, what we did was we identified the blocks that we could migrate from AWS to Oracle Cloud. Like you can see the Tomcat, MongoDB, and whatever data backups they were taking. We just wanted to migrate. We identified that. We decided with Ashish and Mridula, the CTO of Dressire, how they want to scale up a few years down the line. Do they have an integration strategy with any other product that we did? After they were selected, after a couple of months, what we did was we did the migration. Here, this is what you see the Oracle Cloud stack like. We still use the same HAProxy. Are anyone guys using HAProxy or have heard about it? Anyone in the super, like a lot of people use. Like for those who don't know, like it's basically an open source project. Like you can have any Linux machine. You install HAProxy and you can have many virtual machines running. It can have a round robin league of checking whether the machine is up or down. If something is down, it automatically goes to another. This ensures that high availability is there. So we use HAProxy here. This is once again what was running on Oracle Compute, what we call OCI, Oracle Cloud Infrastructure. And the same, the Tomcat, whatever they had, it's once again running on Oracle Compute Infrastructure. They also had an option of using Java Cloud Service, which is in the roadmap, but right now they have not done it. Having said that, they're using block storage, cloud storage, and a couple of compute machines. The MongoDB that they were using on AWS, they also migrated onto Oracle Cloud. And in terms of PaaS, platform as a service, they're using MySQL to manage some of the data. And the latest thing in terms of analytics and report has been Analytics Cloud. It's something very similar to data visualization or DV Cloud, what we used to call. And they're using that for analysis of data that they're getting. And this is how the bigger picture looks like once they're migrated. So, and the couple of things that they have in the roadmap is they want to integrate with IoT. Basically, when they walk into a store, they want to do a facial recognition or read an RFID or do some sort of IoT related stuff. So that's what they're also trying to do in the near future. In terms of SaaS, the marketing cloud service is something that they are using. And this is how the overall architecture looks like right now. And we'll be adding more components to that as we proceed further. Any questions on technology part of it? Ashish, back to you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sorry. I was also managing it.
Okay. So this is from the business perspective, like where each data fits, because business wants to know what they own, what Dressire owns, especially with the GDPR in Europe. They are really sensitive with the what customer data goes where. So this picture tells you about what fits in the retailer's space and what is in with Dressire. So though retailer has the customer information, it's something that retailer keeps with itself. We just take a mobile number and we just build the profile based on what questions we ask. So our customer data is completely separate from the retailer. As long as they are happy to share the loyalty data, only then we take those feeds and we probably use it for marketing or, you know, marketing mailers. So, Yeah, and these are the various components that we'll be using for doing the analytics, or we use it with our existing case studies also, where we get the customer profile, the product profile, because we tell them the best styles, the customers, or, you know, what they are looking for and what are the trends, and based on that they can stock it, or, you know, they can even ask their product team to design it. So these are the various parameters that we have. So it has a Dressire managed product sales info as well, because after a person has liked it, whether the customer purchased it or not is also based on it. So we also do some analysis on that and give the, you know, invoice value or what was the contribution of Dressire to make that sale happen. So.
Next one.
Yeah, so so far we have a retailer based application where we want to integrate with the retailer. But we are looking for doing, this is something in our future that we want to do, that we want to have our own application, Dressire application, such that a customer can log in with any social media plugins we'll be using, so that they can log in from Facebook, Twitter, or, you know, any of those, and they can go to multiple retailers. So the suggestions that we give would be from all the retailers, not only from one retailer. So this will be a customer-centric app that we are looking for. And we'll also be able to give them some customer-relevant marketing posts, which they can post on FB, Instagram, or any of these social media sites. Because now that we know the customer, we know what she likes, we can obviously give them the, you know, those marketing mailers. So probably somebody doesn't want to know a particular item that has come in, so that mail won't go to that particular customer because it's not in her area of liking, you know. So based on that, we give some relevant marketing posts.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
So if you are planning to give this to a customer side now, this application, don't you think you will be promoting more online shopping?
This is for in-store experience
right now.
Yes.
So it's more of a digital first strategy that we have. See, what we know is that 70% of the, you know, customers have already made a decision on what they want to buy before they step into a store, which means our point of influence is much before, on the go, wherever they are, you know, at home, in the office, which is where we want to reach out to. So it's a digital first strategy, you know, which would be aligned with the retailer's, you know, own digital, you know, transformation plan. And, you know, we would, along with them, reach out to them. Now, this is as per the other option that Nidhala is talking about, where we would also continue with that same digital first strategy, where we will have a presence, you know, and be there when the customer wants us. Because our goal is to influence her at the origin of her perception of need, you know, so understand when she wants something and be there. Influence her and then drive her to the nearest store. Yeah, because we see opportunity in that, you know, when we work with retailers.
Yeah, because the inventory that we show on her app would be in-store inventory, so she would know which store to walk into to see what she wants. Analytics cloud is there. Yeah, so it has an analytics cloud there. It's
so here we have the R for ML, AI, all of that. Hmm?
That's our Oracle analytics.
Right.
That's right. Yeah. That's right.
Again, we say we are suggesting you're just one button away from buying.
Yes.
It's again online online store.
and we'll provide that. Why would we deny, you know, a sale when it has to happen? But, you know, what is important is that we need to have, see, there are various categories and various price points of items where customers may want to have the touch and feel and feel that exclusive experience. They may want to, you know, like, as per the latest insights that we have from Gartner, you know, what they say is that click and collect is something which customers really would want. We provide that opportunity as well. You know, they could add any of these items to their cart, to their wish list. They can decide when they would want to pick it up from the store and which store. And you have all of these, you know, sort of retailers who are with us.
Okay, they need to walk in into the store if they have to collect it.
That's right.
Okay,
that's right. Because then you are promoting more of cross sell and upsell for the retailer as well. There is an opportunity for the retailer to provide some clienteling service, right? So
with our outfit builder, I think.
Exactly. Yeah. So we mentioned about the outfit builder and outfit advisory. So there is, you know, more opportunity for, you know, for increasing the cross sales as well. Shall we move on to the next slides? Oh, there are more questions at this stage. We are happy to take questions as you, you know, as we move along. We can keep it interactive. So you covered this? Or you are to cover this?
Yeah, this is more done.
You have to cover, okay.
So we have some more plans with the IoT and mobile services, like having some Bluetooth beacons near the shop where it runs on low Bluetooth energy. So when whoever has our app will get a push notification which says that, you know, whatever you like is there inside the shop, you can just walk in. So those kind of notifications, or if a customer wants some assistance from the client, retailer executive, what we have planned for Dressire is when the customer gets a push notification, she is also asked whether she wants assistance. If she says yes, then a retailer executive will log into her part of the application and look at the customer's preferences and present those items to the customer so that customer can easily get what she wants and can move out as well faster if she's in hurry. So we also have RFID detection plan where we'll be issuing a Dressire card which would have a RFID chip, and the RFID readers can be, you know, installed in the entrance, at the entrance. So whenever the customer comes in, we'll have to write a program which reads the RFID data, and we come to know that a particular customer has entered, and the Dressire assistant can then walk to the customer and help the customer in her journey. Geofencing, again, one of the services that is there, so where we again give the boundary of the shop, and if the customer is around, she gets a notification. Again, she is asked whether she wants assistance. We are not giving a compulsive assistance because sometimes people don't want it, so they might just feel spooked that, you know, every time I go past this shop, they ask me for assistance. So if she opts for it, she gets it. And we are doing a POC for face recognition as well using computer vision, OpenCV. So we are in a process of building that POC where it's actually a plan when a person has a mobile with no Bluetooth on, probably has forgotten her card, doesn't have her GPS on, but obviously has a face there. So we just do the image recognition and find out, you know, who has come in, and we know the customer.
Okay. All right, so, you know, then we come to this next section where we talk about, you know, how we are applying some of the machine learning and AI stuff into doing what we are doing. So as you know, you could, it's important, first of all, you know, to make sure that you do all of these. It's not that, you know, you pick up some particular algorithm and start working on it. It's important to keep experimenting with multiple algorithms depending on the kind of data that you have, depending on the, you know, the volume of data that you have, depending on the kind, you know, the way the outliers get treated, and depending on, you know, how much of an overfitting, you know, problem you would want to solve. Now, of course, you know, using unsupervised learning methods, you know, which essentially are around either clustering or dimensionality reduction. We've tried all of these methods, you know, to understand which is the one that gives us the most accurate output. So we've used, you know, all of these that you've mentioned here, right from, you know, using Gaussian mixture model to, you know, SVD or factor analysis, you know, or even, you know, the K-mode, given the fact that it's more a discrete data, categorical data that we have to deal with. And then, of course, you know, when you look at the supervised learning methods that we've used, right from naive Bayes, you know, to logistic regressions and, you know, using bagging in random forest and all, just to understand the you know, underlying pattern in the data. You know, and then, you know, we've also looked at, like I said, you know, all of the combinations, even CADE or ANN. And then there are some others which are planned once we are able to build a lot of, you know, data points, because, you know, you need for each customer. See, our goal is to be able to predict what each customer should be recommended. Now, that means you need to generate a lot of, you know, sort of, let's say, images, construct a lot of whys, if you will, for each customer, and that needs a lot of deep learning. So, you know, obviously we would go to a combination of GAN and, you know, discriminative, you know, sort of combination, which is where, you know, we would be launching the next phase, you know, once we've understood all of these different, you know, attributional construct, which is where we'll use a combination to reach out to multiple customers, you know, at the next level. I mentioned about the product genome. Now, just to provide you an insight into the extent to which we are going, So, you know, we collect information around hundreds of attributes and the various sub-attributes. So, like I said, you know, if you're looking at, we're not just looking at color or fabric luster or the way the garment drapes, you know, or the hemline length or the type of hemline or the type of sleeve or the length of sleeves, you know, so there are a whole host of, you know, attributes that we look at, a partial list of which is over here. But if you look, drill down at each of these, you know, attributes, and you would see it blows up into multiple levels as well. For example, silhouette, you know, you could look at shift and sheath and, you know, A-line, skater, empire waist, whatever, you know, so there are dozens there as well. And within each of these, there is another layer of complexity, which is around all the other attributes and the interaction with them, you know. So if you look at a particular shift, you have to then look at, you know, the different body types and what it, you know, augments. And you also look at the interplay of patterns, for instance, you know, so what kind of patterns would go well with each of these other attributes and see if there is any confounding effect. You know, then if you look at the other side of the equation, which is the customer profile, so here we collect all of this information, right, you know, from the age group to the location, height, you know, her stated preferences, her unstated preferences as well, you know, because we continue to do the implicit tracking as well, you know. You know, while we are more gung-ho about and we promote the explicit preference profile mechanism, which is we capture the information on the fly about what the customer wants to let us know about her, you know. So we are GDPR compliant, you know, given the fact that we are, you know, also working in Europe, you know, with our sales partner. So we want to make sure that every information about the customer that we collect is compliant to the GDPR norm, and the customer has a right to be forgotten as well, you know. So that is why, you know, we are much more, you know, much more aggressive and much more gung-ho about the explicit preference profile mechanism that we use. Now, here are, you know, some examples of some of the tests output, you know, that we had done. Now, we try to do this in a constrained environment, given the fact that, you know, you could come out with much better results if you had like hundreds of thousands of items. But if you have a constraint, a forced constraint item environment, which means in a given scenario, you know, a customer walks into a store and there are no more than, let's say, 300 dress items. How can the algorithm find, you know, and optimize on some of the best suited garments for her? So, you know, let's say if this is the clickstream information that we are collecting. So the customer is browsing through and she has made these particular clicks. She's looked at each of these items. Now there is a certain pattern in here given those hundreds of attributes that are collected in the background. Okay, so now let's, you know, if you look at the top five personalized items that would appear. Now there is a certain pattern in there, you know. So there was some bright clothes, you know, there was some a kind of a silhouette, you know, there was a kind of pattern. Actually, not much of it, you know, you could see only at the bottom, you know, on the fringes, and then maybe there's a waistband, you know, and then there's a kind of sleeve and a hemline type. So all of those get taken accounted for. And here is the outcome, as we had seen, you know, using this implicit methodology, which means, you know, even as the customer is browsing, we should be on the fly, be able to personalize the entire store for her. And she should be able to see not just, you know, top 10 recommended items. If there are like 10,000 items, we should be able to show her all 10,000 items. She browses through them, you know, in her preferred order. This is the next five set of items. You know, there's a certain pattern in there, you know, which here is, you know, we don't see what we wanted to. There are some prints in here as well, but then this is a constrained environment, like I said. You know, there aren't too many items in there. You know, so the database that we had taken was just about 300, just to demonstrate, you know, that the whole algorithm could work even in this constrained environment. You know, here is the next five, you know, so there are some sheets coming in as well. Now, this is another method, you know, where we look at the historical and the current context of the customer. So the customer's information could reveal that she has bought a certain, you know, certain set of items. These are her current clicks. You know, when she's visiting the site today, she's looked at these particular items. But then we know that she has had looked at, for example, you know, on these particular historical items. Now, how do we know which are the ones that we should be presenting to her? So here are again, you know, top five on the user's product list page. You know, as you can see, there are some, if you look at the current clicks, she's looking at dresses, you know, which are either black or white, have some abstract print, you know, some bold prints, and the silhouette, if you can see the shape, you know, is somewhat more form-fitting. So which is what, you know, it takes into recognition. Here, there is a different sort of a plane, you know, in here. There are more bright colors, you know, it's again black. There are not much of patterns in here. So which is what it takes into cognizance and presents the top five items, you know, which are more form-fitting, which are black or white, you know, have some patterns in here. You know, you would see some bold patterns as well as we move on. So there are some prints in here, you know, again, form-fitting, achromatic. Here are some other bold fonts, you know, which have bold prints, which have come up. So these are all on the first page itself, you know, which shows the top 20 or 25 items where her propensity to click and buy one of these items really goes up. You know, so this is what we wanted to show to you about how our algorithms are working. Now, you know, as you scroll down, you know, let's say there are some three pages. The mid page would have items like these, which definitely have some prints, you know, and these are not as you know, probable for the customer to pick them up. And here are the last ones, the bottom ones. So as you can see, the whole profile of the clothes in here, which are presented to her at the bottom, you know, is actually not suitable given what she is browsing. But then it will learn based on, you know, the clicks and correct itself, because if she clicks on any of these, which means, you know, there are some false, you know, some false positives here as well, no? Which is what, you know, we can correct. And then there is, oh, okay, yeah.
And he has a question.
I'm sorry, I didn't get you.
Is this part of a recommendation to the customer, which is based on the classification algorithm on machine learning?
Yeah, so classification algorithm is part of machine learning itself. Yeah.
So this was built based upon the classification.
That's
algorithm.
Right. That's right. So this is, you know, essentially, you know, around the personalized navigation. Here, the fit element does not come into play. That is a separate feature. Here, I was demonstrating about, you know, how you know, personalization can be provided on the fly when we have some current information about her, when we can leverage the historical data as well or a current clicks. This is implicit. What we had demonstrated on the through the video was none of this. Right, because in that we are engaging the customer. We ask her to look at some items and provide her preferences on each of those. Yeah, so the two methods work very differently.
Thank you.
And here again, you know, if she selected this particular item, then which are the top similar items for her? Now, again, this is, again, a constrained environment. So, you know, it recognizes that it's a maxi length, you know, in here. But, you know, there are some similarities in terms of, if you can see the neckline, it's deep, you know, it's, you know, there's a, the hemline is, you know, till it's more. But in there, it recognizes it. There aren't too many such items, but, you know, these come close to hold the customer's attention. Here are some more, you know. So again, let's say if this is the kind of garment that you select, then here are the similar items. Now you would see some whites in here as well, because of our research and understanding that, you know, the blacks and whites, typically achromatics, you know, go hand in hand. So, you know, these can be shown together. Similarly, you know, there are some more. If you notice, you know, the one over here is pretty much and you know, a skater dress, and the top three items, even this gets figured out, probably the same model as well. Maybe the algorithm is recognizing the model too. Again, you know, here it's got a different sort of a fall, and you know, if you can see, the algorithm recognizes that the top half has a different play, you know, to the entire feel of the garment, and this is what it could get, you know, closest to. This one has a sort of a similar, but not much, resemblance to the previous one, but then these are working in a constrained environment. Here there are, you know, it's a printed body hugging sort of a item, and you've got a similar one, you know, over there, and most of these, you know, are pretty much similar in terms of the other attributes. Well, so that's all we had, and we'd be happy to take more questions if you will. Yeah, so that's, you know, so we've used a lot of our own proprietary algorithms. So, you know, especially the knowledge that we bring in understanding and deconstructing the entire garment comes from us, you know. So we tied up with NIFT, and, you know, we ourselves picked up this particular field, and we're not just picking up some algorithms from the library, because that can be very easily copied.
Yeah, sorry, I think my question was not on algorithm, and my question is not about fashion.
Okay.
Suppose a startup is interested in building a personalization framework in showing it in the website. Now let's say food or some completely different domain, and there is some algorithm deciding what is first, what is matching. The matching part is separate. Once you know what is closer, how to display it, how to bring the top ones in the front and the not so relevant ones in the middle and the ones in the back.
Yeah.
That part of it, did you build the entire UI from scratch?
That's right. That's right.
From scratch.
So we have a ranking mechanism for all the items. Like I said,
correct.
If there are a million items, we'll have a score for each and every item. And they are, it's like a Google page rank. Okay. So, you know, it ranks pages, but here we rank the products.
Correct.
Every product has got a certain number associated with it. And it's, you know, it's rank sorted in that particular manner.
Yeah,
and it's broken down to the different attributes as well. So we know the preferences for each item connected to a customer and how the interplay works. So using this, you know, we can construct what she may want to buy in the future as well.
Got it. Okay.
Yeah?
Thank you.
The yeah.
Ranking is the scoring, personalized scoring. It's not a common ranking.
It's personalized. It's not a common ranking at all. Otherwise, it wouldn't work. If it's a common ranking, again, they will end up seeing the same thing. All the customers would see the same thing.
How do you merge historical and current
I'm sorry, I didn't get you.
How do you merge historical and current trends? You give some weightage.
Yeah, so it's based on, you know, some just like you do forecasting. You start off, you know, it's as good as tossing a coin. You assign a 50-50, let's say, weightage, and then as you progress, you adjust the weights. Yes, it varies.
It's not a fixed.
No, it's not fixed. It wouldn't work if it's fixed, because it has to be dynamic and it has to keep learning.
Okay.
Sorry, are you done with the question, or you had some more?
No.
Pricing. Okay, pretty good question. You know, if the retailer wants it, yes, because one of our options that we provide is, you know, optimizing on the price front. And I'll give you an example. There is a certain retailer in Europe that we are trying to work with. What they do is, you know, they sell unsold garments, unsold inventory of the top brands. You know? So you have an Armani and they couldn't, you know, sell certain pieces of garment. Now, they sort of stock those items and, you know, they have a digital storefront and, you know, you can buy from there. The model works in a manner that you could provide the advisory service to them saying that these particular items, you know, while you have marked them down by 50%, perhaps have users who could have bought them at full price. So you save dollars for them. So optimal pricing, to answer your question, yes, that's definitely needed, but not to the extent which a certain retailer had done and got beating, you know, because customers started complaining, hey, given my profile, you know that I am rich and, you know, you are pricing me higher. No, not that. So I don't want to take names, but...
For pricing, you may want to mention Stitch Now, where we tell you what should be the optimized price.
That, okay, yeah, so well, you know, there is another model that we are working on, but, you know, I know it's in the pilot stage, so without, spending too much time on it, what I would say is, we provide this option for the customer also to be able to build, to be able to, you know, tell us what they want, and we build the pricing accordingly, you know, so that's, thanks for bringing that out. So that's another thing that we, you know, customer-centric, you know, everything from the customer side, you're not sort of, you know, playing games with the customer. That is precisely what we want to do.
And is there any insights given to a new, like, suppose I want to create, I'm a factory or something, so I want to create a release, a new product. So are there any insights given for the new
Absolutely.
Design and stuff?
Absolutely.
Like which design gets a
Yes, yes. That's one of our modules as well. Okay. And that is what we want to do. So in our demand planning insight module, currently what we do is, there is an aggregate set of customers and we understand their behaviors. We understand what they want. You take all that information together and say, hey, you know, given these set of customers that you currently have, here are their preferences. Here is what the aggregate set of customers would want. And here is what you're buying, you know, in the, case study that Mridula presented on the lingerie brand, that's exactly, you know, what we have in the brand, in that slide. The, given the customers, you know, who took the fit test, here is the set of, items, products, SKUs that they, would want. And here is what, you know, you have in stock. So here is an opportunity for you to correct, right? So you can have an understanding of what is the universal preference score for a particular customer and a product, and then you can compare it with how it stacks versus against what they currently have. So there is a scope for improvement, you know, and it provides them this entire spectrum of visibility as to what they have versus what they should be making, because that's a blind spot for them. They don't know what they don't know. Okay.
Yeah. Nice.
Is it possible that a personalized model may perform poorly compared to a more generic model, some clustered or region model?
So
you're not probably giving it a chance if you only express the
personalized model?
Like then it's purely random. You've got a 50% chance of, you know, stumbling upon something that you wanted.
So is there something you can do to counter that?
Yeah, the best way is to test it, and we have had, you know, we've gone through that process on the fly. You know, when we have set up our booth, and you know, there were retailers who said, okay, here are some of our, you know, women colleagues, let's run this test past them and see how well it works. So to quote you an example,
some,
you know,
kind of a store level model or a regional model.
Yes, we have that.
Better than a customer specific model.
No, I didn't get this last part.
Couldn't a store level or a regional model, which has greater data points to
I get your point. Yes.
Counter,
with, yes.
Wouldn't that work? It may work better for a customer
than
a customer.
And that's how it works. We don't have that in the demo, right? We have it in the slide. Okay. So the very first screen the customer sees is how they would want to choose the inventory level. Store level, city level, or pan country. So when you choose store level, your closet would show items only from that store. If you choose pan, across the city, then let's say if you are in lifestyle, you would be able to see all the inventory suited for you across all lifestyle stores in the city. Let's say you're standing, you know, at 100 feet. That's our option B, the model that we have, coming up. So if you are at 100 feet road, Indranagar, it will build your personal closet out of let's say, all fashion shops within a mile radius. And it will help you know which particular shop to walk into and you know, and get what you are looking for. But yes, you know, what's important is to show them an endless aisle to choose from rather than restrict themselves to, you know, smaller inventory items.
In different colors. Okay, so wouldn't it be better like if you can give a single dress and lots of colors?
Yes, we fold the recommendations. Otherwise, you know, they will have to scroll through so many pages and it will get boring. Yes, we face that. Okay. Because that's what the algorithm would see. They will bring all the blacks together and then, you know, it's a cumbersome process for her to sift through. So you fold all of that, you know, and let her see only, you know, one of its kind. You know, so that's... Yes. And there are other factors also, not just the color. But here, the dominant factor is the color, because that's what, you know, the customer wouldn't want to see. There may be changes to the shape or the fabric or the pattern, and that is fine. You know, so you're right. That's how it works. I can't hear you, sorry. What data?
Visualization
for the retailers. So there are, you know, multiple levels of visualization that they would be able to see. They would be able to see, you know, at a customer level, if they want, what is the personal closet for each customer. They would be able to see, you know, I'm moving from, you know, bottom to, you know, to the top level. They would be able to see for a store level what are the top products which are suited to an aggregate set of customers who, you know, who are frequenting that store. They would be able to segment, you know, slice and dice this data based on their loyal customers versus non-loyal customers. And, you know, that was a good insight that we could see when we were doing this with one of the top retailers. You know, the conversions for their non-loyalty customers was much higher. It jumped up by 183% compared to the conversions that we had for loyal customers. So those are the kind of, you know, insights that you can provide apart from the product information, you know, what they should stock, what they should buy, what they should manufacture. So all of that information, you know, they would be able to have. And then there is a clienteling part as well, right? So we mostly promote an opt-in. While Madhusudhan did touch upon, you know, all the other stuff that we are trying to do, which looks cool, sensor fusion and you know, augmented reality for face detection and, you know, the facial recognition. But what we are primarily looking at is the customer opting in voluntarily to let the retailer know that she is in the store and she would want to have an exclusive service. Once she signs up, you know, in the store, she sees the entire inventory personalized for her. Now, that is the opportunity we use to provide a clienteling service as well, which is, you know, there is a notification to the retailer and from the retailer, you know, to the appropriate sales staff to be able to know who the customer is, what her prior history is, what kind of a profile she has, demographic, you know, psychosociographic, all of that, along with her preferences for clothes and the next best action for her. So all of this information, you know, would be presented to. So that's another slice and dice, you know, piece of information that can be leveraged in real time by the retailer.
Yeah, and we are using Oracle DV if you are interested in the tool. The Oracle. After moving to the Oracle.
Yeah, that's a short response to the big explanation I provided. But yes, we are using Oracle DV for, you know, the various visualization.
I think he asked tool.
So any more questions? Happy to take more questions. I'm sorry?
How many stores have you reached?
Okay, so, you know, with lingerie, there are 18 across two. And then jewelry, we are starting off with three, you know? And that's where we are. And, you know, we are also doing a product genome construction for a certain other, you know, party. So, you know, that would help us, you know, train our, you know, our algorithms better. Yeah. And once this is done, you know, the opportunity to scale is huge because the kind of retailers, brands that, you know, that we have, they have like 3,000 plus, you know, multi-brand outlets. They have tie-ups with the national chain stores, you know, which is 250, 300 plus, and their own exclusive brand outlets, which is around 15 to 20. So yeah, the opportunity is huge once the results are driven home well. If the outcome is any such indication, there should be. Okay. Thank you so much.
Actually,
for being
there was one more thing I wanted to ask.
Yeah.
So in Future Group, what happens is, so the shipment moves from one store to another. Like the same shipment, suppose it gets rejected. Let's say 50 pieces of some product ID. Okay, they go through first the merchandise, the exclusive thing, outlet, and then goes to the next one, then hops to the next one. You're getting me? So how does it track over here? Like, suppose some product has a low conversion ratio. So let's say I move from this outlet to the next outlet. So the next outlet will have its own customer, customers over there.
I get
you. And they should have its own another pricing, another. So is there any analytics over that also and the conversion?
Not yet. What you're talking about is a beautiful problem to solve in the next step as well.
Yeah.
You know, when we get deeply integrated with the retailer, okay. As of now, the best that we can do is the current set of retailers that we are talking to, what they've agreed upon is to provide a data feed refresh every 5 minutes. So it's up to them to help us understand what is the stock status of each of their SKUs. No? And that's what we'll have to take. But we cannot really go in and behind the scenes and work to make visible their inventory, which is in transit and at different stages. That's a different problem to solve. And that would, in a way, deviate us as well from our core, which is of providing recommendations. We'll see when we get there. Okay. Are we done? Any more questions?
No, I guess.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for the wonderful audience you've been. Thanks for the questions.